Hello, good morning everybody. Thank you. Detail about scalp. What is the scalp? It is the soft tissue covering the cranial vault. It is hair bearing area of the skull. Extend from supraorbital margin anteriorly to external occipital protuberance and supranuchal line posteriorly on each side superior temporal line. So here you can see this scalp ka jo naam hai SCLP. So it covered by the five layer. SCALP. So what is the scalp? So scalp is a soft tissue covering the cranial vault from the scalp. It extends from the anteriorly supraorbital margin, posteriorly external occipital protuberance, and superiorly. Superiorly there is a supranuchal line. Posteriorly external occipital protuberance, supranuchal line, and each side there is a superior temporal line. So structure covering the scalp, there is a superficial temporal region study with the scalp and the following there is a scalp is made of this five layer. So name SCLP. S ka matlab hai skin, superficial fascia, connective tissue. C, deep fascia in the form of this epicranial aponeurosis or the glia aponeurotica with the occipitofrontalis muscles and low cerebellar tissue and pericranium. So this one are the five layers: skin, connective tissue, superficial fascia, aponeurosis or the glia aponeurotica, low cerebellar tissue and the pericranium. So first, what is the skin of the skull? The skin is thick and hairy. It is adherent to the epicranial aponeurosis through the dense superficial fascia and in the palm and sole. It has a more numerous of the sweat gland and sebaceous gland. So skin of the scalp, it is the thick skin. It contains the more amount of the sweat and sebaceous gland. The second one are the connective tissue or the superficial fascia. The subcutaneous of the superficial fascia is more fibrous and the dense in center than in the periphery of the head. It contains the many blood vessels in bind the skin to the subjacent aponeurosis and the provide a proper medium for the passage of the vessels and the nerve of the skin. Now aponeurosis for the glia aponeurotica. So aponeurosis, it is the part of this layer of this the skin. So aponeurosis are the deep fascia in the form of this epicranial aponeurosis or the glia aponeurotica with the occipitofrontalis muscles. So what is the occipitofrontalis muscles? Occipitofrontalis muscle has a two belly, occipital or the occipitalis and the frontal or the frontalis, both of which are the inserted into the epicranial aponeurosis. The occipital bellies are small and the separate and arise from the lateral two-thirds of the superior nuchal line and is supplied by this posterior auricle branch of the facial nerve. And frontal bellies are longer, wider and partly united in the median plan. Each arise from the skin of the upper eyelid and forehead. So with the orbicular oculi and the corrugator supraciliary, which supplied by the temporal branch of this facial nerve. The muscle raise the eyebrow and cause the horizontal wrinkles in the skin of the forehead. The temporoparietal muscles is present on the lateral side, which arise from the temporal fascia and fuse with this epicranial aponeurosis. It is supplied by the temporal branch of this cranial facial nerve. So epicranial aponeurosis, it is the third layer of this scalp. The epicranial aponeurosis of the glia aponeurotica is freely movable from the pericranium, along with this overlying and adherent skin and the fascia. Anteriorly, it received the insertion of this frontalis. Posteriorly, it received the insertion of the occipitalis muscles attached to external occipital protuberance into the highest nuchal line in between the occipital belly. On each side, aponeurosis attached to the superior temporal line, but send down a thin extension which passes over the temporal fascia and is attached to the zygomatic arch. First three layers of the scalp are called the surgical layer of this scalp. So skin, connective tissue and aponeurosis called the surgical layer of this scalp. So this called the scalp proper. The fourth layer of the scalp is made up of this low cerebellar tissue. So low cerebellar tissue contains the fat cells or the adipose cells. So here it extends anteriorly into the eyelid. because the frontalis muscle has no bony attachment, posteriorly to the highest and the superior nuchal line, and on each side to the superior temporal line. It gives passage to the emissary vein, which connect the extracranial vein to the intracranial venous sinuses. And fifth layer are the pericranium. So this one are the fifth layer. So fifth layer of the skull called the pericranium is loosely attached to the surface of the bone, but it firmly adherent to their structures where the sutural ligament bind and the pericranium to the endocranium. So these are the description of this five layer of this scalp. So name is given this scalp. First layer is skin, thick skin. Second layer are the superficial fascia of the connective tissue. Third layer are the gliaponeurotica. Fourth are the loose areolar tissue. Fifth one are the pericranium. Now skin are the thick and hairy, firmly attached to the epicranial aponeurosis. Third, the dense fascia, evident sebaceous gland and sebaceous cyst are common. So these one are the applied related to the scalp sebaceous. Second layer are the connective tissue, its fibrous and the dense containing blood vessels and the nerves. Bind skin to subjacent aponeurosis. Wound bleed profusely and the blood vessels are the prevented from the detraction by the fibrous tissue. Bleeding is stopped by the applying the pressure against the bone. Subcutaneous hemorrhage are not extensive since fascia is dense. Inflammation cause the little swelling but are much painful. So this one are the second layer loose connective tissue or the superficial fascia. Third are the aponeurosis. So epicranial aponeurosis, also name is given the glia aponeurotica. So this glia aponeurotica is nothing but there is a insertion of these all three muscles, anteriorly frontalis muscles, posteriorly occipital muscles, and laterally temporalis nerve muscles. So name is given this aponeurosis. Aponeurosis ka matlab kya hai? Flattened tendon. So it is nothing but insertion of these all three muscles, anteriorly frontalis muscles. So this one are the flattened tendon or the aponeurotic part of these muscles, occipital frontalis muscles. So glia aponeurotica with this occipital frontalis muscle at the third layer. Anteriorly frontal belly and posterior occipital belly of the occipital frontalis muscles. Frontal belly originate from the skin of the forehead and migrate with this orbicularis oculi muscles. Occipital belly originate from the lateral two-third of the superior nuchal line. It gaps it if cut transversely and should be stitched. Now fourth layer are the loose areolar tissue. Loose areolar tissue, it extends anteriorly into the eyelid because frontalis has no bony attachment. Posteriorly to superior nuchal line, on each side to the superior temporal line. Bleeding causes the generalized swelling of the scalp. While the dangerous layer of the scalp or emissary vein open here and carry any infection inside the brain or the venous sinus. Bleeding lead to the black eye and Caput's cesuodenum in newborn. So this one are the applied anatomy related to the scalp. Name is given this bleeding. It led to this black eye. So wound of the scalp gap when this epicranial aponeurosis is divided transversely. Because of the abundant of the sebaceous gland, the scalp is common site for the sebaceous cyst. Wound of the scalp bleed profusely because the vessels are prevented from the retracting by the fibrous fascia. And bleeding can be arrested by applying the pressure at the site of the injury by the tight cotton bandage against the bone. So bleeding led to the black eye. So because of this density of the fascia, subcutaneous hemorrhage are never extensive. And inflammation in the layer caused the little swelling but much pain. Because the pericranium is adherent to the suture, collection of the fluid deep to the pericranium known as the cephalohematoma take the shape of this bone. Concerned with this, there is a fractures in the partial bone. The layer of this loose areolar tissue is known as the dangerous area of this skull because loose areolar tissue when Caput's cesuodenum in the newborn and the bleeding led to the black eye. Why it is called the dangerous area of the skull? Because of this emissary vein, which course here may transmit infection from the skull to the cranial venous sinuses. So collection of this blood in this layer, loose connective tissue, causes the generalized swelling of the skull. The blood may extend anteriorly into the root of this nose and into the eyelid. As the frontalis muscles has bony origin and causing the resulting in the black eye. The posterior limit of the such hemorrhage is not seen. If bleeding is due to the local injury, the posterior limit of the hemorrhage is seen. So because of this spread of this blood, compression of this brain is not seen, and so this layer is also called the safety layer. Since the blood supply of the scalp and the superficial temporal region is very rich, avascular portion need not to cut away. They can be replaced in the position and stitch. They usually take up and heal well. So this one are the applied related along the scalp. Now pericranium. So pericranium, it is the periosteum of the skin. It attaches with this loosely attached to the surface of the bone, but is firmly attached to the suture. So pericranium also, it is the part of this at fourth layer of this fifth layer of this scalp, or the pericranium, is loosely attached to the surface of this bone, but is firmly attached to the suture, where the sutural ligament bind the pericranium to the endotendon. So this one are the fifth layer of this scalp, loosely attached to the surface of this bone, but is firmly adhered to the suture. Injury deep to it take the shape of this bone. Name is given the cephalohematoma. Scalping injury should be replaced and the stitch because the healing is better, because it's profuse blood supply, so it heal properly. Now superficial temporal region, it is the lateral side of this this one are the cephalohematoma. Here there is a collection of this fluid deep to the pericranium. So these are the cephalohematoma. So loose areolar tissue hai, known as the danger area, because it contains the emissary vein, which course here may transmit the infection from the scalp to the cranial venous sinuses. In collection of blood in this layer, loose connective tissue, for the generalized swelling of the scalp. The blood may extend anteriorly into the root of this nose and into the eyelid. So, lead causing resulting in black eye. So, this condition, clinical condition, name is given this black eye. So, black eye, it is the indication of this collection of this blood within the loose areolar tissue or scalp injury. So the position limit in such hemorrhage is not seen if bleeding is due to the local injury. The posterior limit of the hemorrhage is seen. Because of the spread of this blood, compression of the brain is not seen, and so that layer is also called the safety layer. Since the blood supply of the scalp and the superficial temporal region is very rich, evils portion need not to cut away. They can be replaced in position and stitch. They usually take up and heal well. Now muscles of the scalp. So first there is occipital. Frontalis muscles has two bellies, occipital and frontal both. So occipital frontalis muscles are the part of this anteriorly frontalis muscle, and posteriorly there is a occipital muscles. So this occipital frontalis muscle has a occipital frontalis muscle is anteriorly frontalis, is are longer, wider, and partly united in this median plane. It arises from the skin of the upper eyelid and forehead, margin with this orbicularis oculi and the corrugator supercilium. It supplies the temporal branch of this facial nerve. And occipital frontalis has two belly, occipital and frontal, both of which are inserted into the epicranial aponeurosis. It is supplied by the posterior auricular branch of this facial nerve, occipital part, and the temporal branch of this facial nerve supply the frontal branch. So occipital muscles has a two belly, occipital and frontalis, both of which are the inserted into the epicranial aponeurosis. The occipital belly are small and separate. It arises from this lateral two-third of this superior nuchal line and is supplied by this posterior auricular branch of this facial nerve. So posterior auricular branch of facial nerve supply the occipital part, In temporal branch of this fascia nerve supply the frontal nerve muscles. So these two muscles collectively name is given this occipital frontalis muscle. Both are inserted into the epicranial aponeurosis. So this layer, it is the third layer of this scalp, name is given this the fascia in form of this epicranial aponeurosis or the glia aponeurotica, which are insertion of this occipital frontalis muscles. So here you can see this diagram. These are the fibers of this frontal valleys of this occipital frontalis muscle. This one are the epicranial aponeurosis. Posteriorly there is occipital fibers or the occipital valley of this occipital frontalis muscle. Both fibers arise anteriorly and posteriorly, and centrally there is a insertion of these two muscles, name is given this glia aponeurotica or the epicranial aponeurosis. Laterally there is a origin of this temporalis muscles. So these are the temporal region. Also you can cover here superficial temporal region. It is the area between the superior temporal line and the zygomatic arch. This area contains the skin, superficial fascia, thin extension of this epicranial aponeurosis, which give origin to the extensing muscles of this auricle, temporal fascia, temporalis muscles and pericranium, and tempers means time, gathering hair first start here. So this one are the temporalis region, auricular, so superficial temporal muscles. Now blood supply of this scalp. So first arterial supply. So artery are the supratrochlear artery, supraorbital artery, superficial temporal, posterior auricular artery and occipital artery, and vein follow the artery. So artery supply of the scalp at the superficial region. In front of this auricle, the scalp will supply from this before backward by the supratrochlear, supraorbital and the superficial temporal artery. Supraorbital, supratrochlear and superficial temporal artery. The first two, supratrochlear and the supraorbital artery, the branch of this ophthalmic artery, which is turning branch of this internal carotid artery. And superficial temporal, is a branch of this external carotid artery. Behind the auricle, the scalp is supplied from before backward by the posterior auricular occipital artery, both of which are the branch of this external carotid artery. So this one are the arterial pattern of this scalp. This scalp has a rich blood supply derived from the both internal and external carotid artery. Two system anastomosis over the temple. So near the temple, here there is an anastomosis, both branches of this internal carotid artery and branches of this external carotid artery. The supratrochlear and supraorbital and superficial temporal artery, posterior auricular artery and occipital artery. This artery are the ultimately branch of this internal and external carotid artery. Now venous drainage, it is same as follow the artery. Here the vein of the scalp accompany the artery, and here the similar name, supratrochlear and the supraorbital vein united at the medial angle of the eye, forming the angular vein, which continue down as a facial vein. The superficial temporal vein descend in front of this tragus, inverted the parotid, entered the parotid gland, and joined the maxillary vein to form the temporomandibular vein. This vein divide into the two division, anterior division of the retromandibular vein, anterior division of the retromandibular vein and the fascia to form a vein with the facial vein to form a common facial vein, which drain into this internal jugular vein. And posterior division of the retromandibular vein unite with this posterior auricular vein to form this external jugular vein, which ultimately drain into the subclavian vein. The occipital vein terminate in the suboccipital venous plexus. An emissary vein connect the extracranial vein with this intracranial venous sinuses. To equalize the pressure, this vein are valvulus. The parietal emissary vein pass through the parietal foramen to enter the superior sagittal sinus. And mastoid emissary vein pass through the mastoid foramen to reach the sigmoid sinus. Remaining emissary vein are enter into the skull to the dural venous sinus. So here there is a venous drainage is very important, because the extracranial infection may spread through this vein to the intracranial venous sinuses. Diploid vein start from this cancellous bond within these two tables of this skull. They carry the from the blood cells into the general circulation. These are four veins on each side. The frontal diploid vein emerge at the supraorbital notch, open into the supraorbital vein. Anterior temporal diploid vein and in the anterior deep temporal vein or the spinoparietal sinus. Posterior temporal diploid vein and in this transverse sinus and occipital diploid vein open either into the occipital vein or into the transverse sinus near the median plane. Or lymphatic drain and nerve supply. So nerve supply of this scalp and the temple are supplied by the 10 nerves on each side. Out of these 5 nerves, 4 sensory and 1 motor enter the scalp in front of this auricle. The remaining 5 nerves, again 4 sensory and the 1 motor, enter the scalp behind the auricle. So this one are the nerve supply of this scalp. So nerve of this scalp and the superficial temporal sensory nerve. In front of this auricle and behind the auricle, there is a supratrochlear nerve, supraorbital nerve, zygomaticotemporal nerve, auriculotemporal nerve, and temporal branch of this facial nerve. This one at the front of this auricle. The supratrochlear, it is a branch of this frontal ophthalmic division of this trigeminal nerve. Supraorbital, it is a branch of this frontal ophthalmic division of this trigeminal nerve. Zygomaticotemporal, branch of this zygomatic nerve, maxillary division of this trigeminal nerve, and auriculotemporal, branch of this mandibular division of this trigeminal nerve, and one motor temporal branch of this facial nerve. Last one. This one are the motor, this above four, this one are the sensory nerve. So motor nerve, temporal branch of this facial nerve. And behind the auricle, there is a posterior division of this greater auricular nerve. So greater auricular nerve, it is the C2, C3 from the cervical plexus. Lesser occipital nerve, this one are the lesser occipital nerve, it arises C2 from the cervical plexus. Then greater occipital nerve, arises C2 in dorsal ramus. C2 in dorsal ramus. Third occipital nerve, arises C3 in dorsal ramus. Third occipital nerve, arises C3 in dorsal ramus. One motor posterior auricular branch of this facial nerve. So posterior auricular branch of this facial nerve, this one only the motor nerve. Rest of this nerve are the sensory. So in front of this auricle and behind the auricle, this one are the nerve supply of this skull. Now lymphatic drainage. Anterior part and posterior part. Anterior part preauricular parotid group of the lymph node. And posterior part, posterior mastoid group of this lymph node and occipital group of this lymph node. So lymphatic drainage is divided into this anterior part of the scalp, drain into the preauricular or the parotid lymph node, situated on the surface of the parotid gland, and the posterior part of the scalp drain into the posterior auricular or the mastoid and the occipital lymph node. Posterior auricle, mastoid and occipital lymph node. So here is one of the lymphatic drainage of this scalp. Now here there is a complete the topic of this scalp and its applied anatomy related to this applied anatomy. So right eye black eye due to this injury to the scalp and left eye black eye due to the local injury. So this one are the applied anatomy of this scalp. Here there is a complete the class of this scalp. Thank you.